I hope y'all heard the message, because that's what we're talking about today. Who does God say that you are? Who does God say that you are? Did everyone get a handout? Okay, you can follow along with this today, or you can just put it up and go home and look at it. It's full of a compilation of several scriptures on who the Bible says we are. And a lot of these are common, everyday scriptures, things that you've known for years. But what I learned in life was that I became a child of God 34 years ago when I got born again. But here recently, I'm getting a deeper revelation of what that means. And these scriptures would just be dead letter to you without the Holy Spirit. But if you'll pray and ask the Holy Spirit to illuminate, enlighten, give you revelation of what they mean, then I'll pray that you'll have the similar experience that I've had. I've been going over this material for 2 or 3 weeks now, and oftentimes I'm just meditating on one of these verses, and all of a sudden the Holy Spirit would, as it were, light on the verse, and I would just start weeping because I was overwhelmed by what it meant, and I never had seen that depth in those verses. It's because the Satan has tried to give me a false identity my whole life. And once you learn who you are in Christ, I'm telling you, everything will change for the better in your life. You will be changed. So we're talking about blind spots. Remember, we started the year off with a theme of returning to 2020 spiritual vision. And I identified these four blind spots I feel like the Lord put on my heart. One was the spiritual strongholds. We had a lesson on that. Number two, spiritual warfare. It's what we talked about last week. We're just blind to a lot of the demonic oppression going on all around our life. And I hope y'all learned something from that. And I hope you've been more aware and learned how to fight the enemy in a greater way. And the third thing we're really blind to is we don't see ourselves like God sees us. It's just hard to accept that. It's hard to believe that. It's hard to say that about yourself, who you really are. So we're going to have fun with this. I won't try to do every scripture. We'll just go until it's time to quit. And I'm praying you'll have a life-changing experience. I don't even know how to share this. I just want you to have a life-changing experience from it. I want your heart to be overwhelmed by these great truths. So what's your true identity? Do you see yourself the way God sees you? I could say a lot of things about my identity. I'm a husband, and from Liz's perspective, that's probably the way she sees me. I'm also a father, and my three children see me from that context. I'm a son. I still got my mom, my dad alive, thank God. I'm a brother. I got two siblings. I'm a businessman, and for many, many years, probably the greater majority of my people see me that way, people that I've known or connected with. I'm a cattle farmer. That's what I love doing, because cows love me back. They don't lie, cheat, or steal. They love me. I put a bag of feed on my shoulder and walk out there to them. They all run up to me like I'm the greatest person in the world. And there's a whole circle of friends in my world in the longhorn industry. They only know me as a cattle farmer. I'm also a pastor. That's how you know me. Or maybe a Bible teacher. Hey, thank you. Amen. I'm known to some as a friend of the poor. I'm known to very few as a poet. I'd love that. Or a writer wannabe. That's what I'd really like to be. But every one of those things are temporal identities. Ecclesiastes 1:14, Solomon wrote, "I observed everything going on under the sun on the earth, and really it's all meaningless. It's like chasing the wind," he concluded. Everything under the sun, everything on the earth, all these temporal identities. You may be that in your own mind, or people may see you that way, identify you that way. But I'm telling you right now, when your body goes in the grave, you know, you're not really going to be a cattle farmer or a businessman. Or, you know, it's who you are in Christ that matters. What's your true identity? Who are you? When you look in the mirror, who are you? See, because the devil's put false labels on us our whole life. You may some people just say, "I'm worthless." And because someone told them that when they were young, so they believe that all their life. I'm good for nothing. Look at some of these labels. I'm a failure. I'm stupid. Just because somebody told you you're stupid doesn't mean you're stupid. You're an idiot. You're a loser. You're a sinner. You're ugly. You're a dirty, rotten sinner. You can't measure up. You're a drug addict. You're a porn addict. You're just an angry man. You never get it right. You're a nobody. You're a depressed person. Just because you were depressed at a time in your life doesn't mean you're a depressed person. Just because you may fight that from time to time, that's not who it identifies you. You're drunk. You're a womanizer. You're bad. Any of these labels before you got saved, beloved, you got to understand, all these labels died with your old man. They died and were eradicated at the cross. This is not who you are anymore. You've been given a new man, a new life. You've been born again into a new family, into a new kingdom. You may have been these things, but the devil wants you to wear this label all of your life. And beloved, you've got to come to grips that you're not this anymore. You're not who you were before you were saved. You were born in sin, in Adam. You've been born again in Christ. Christ now, who is your life? It's a whole different, a new life. You're a brand new person. Bad person. Not good enough. Misfit. Misfits seem to work for me wherever. I always just figure, well, the reason I don't fit in everywhere, I'm a misfit. And that's, so I wore that like some kind of proud thing. I'm not a misfit. I fit perfectly in the family of God. I fit perfectly in my place in the body of Christ. I fit. You're not a misfit. Flawed. Trash. I'll never mount to anything. I need to try harder. I'm wrestling with my old man again. I'm at the end of the line. There's a Christian song out there that says, this guy was singing about these false labels, and one of these labels was, I was always the kid at the end of the line. Beloved, when the devil, his whole goal is to try to get you to lose or not know about or forget who you are in Christ. Your truest identity is who you are in Christ. Your identity determines your behavior. If you believe you're a no good sinner, guess how you're going to live? Like a no good sinner. You believe you're any of these negative labels, you're a failure, worthless, you're going to live like you're a failure, worthless. Your behavior doesn't determine your identity. Instead, your identity determines your behavior. Just because the way you're acting, human beings will try to interpret that and put a label on you. When you know who you are in Christ, it's going to change your behavior so much. This holy, sanctified life you've always wanted to live, now you're going to be able to live it because you know who you are and you're going to live out of that new identity. Believe what God says about you is true and begin to live holy, sanctified life that God's called you to live. Most believers cannot see themselves like God sees them. They're blind to this. This is really a blind spot. Very few people can see it the way God calls it. We cannot afford to entertain one thought about us that is not the way God thinks about us. I love that statement. What does God say about you? If you're a Christian, if you're saved, if you're born again, a believer, then you need to believe what God says about you is true instead of what others say or what you feel or what the devil says about you. Many people say, Pastor Bill, I just don't feel holy. I don't feel sanctified. I don't feel like a new man. When did God say you're to go by your feelings? You're not to go by your feelings. You're to go by faith. You're to go by, let's believe what God says is true and live by that. I love this verse in 1 Corinthians 15. Paul wrote, I am what I am, but by the grace of God, I am what I am, but by the grace of God, I am what I am. We're not the I am, the great I am. There's a sermon out there online that's horrible, heretical, blasphemous by a human being saying, I am rich, I am, you know, powerful, I am handsome, I am, and you just put all these taglines behind I am. No, you ain't God. You're not what you're not. But Paul was saying in the other context, he is who he is. I'm not ashamed of who I am in Christ. I'm not being proud and arrogant when I say who I am in Christ. Jesus died to give me this identity. So I am what I am. Amen. Paul was an apostle. Paul was a teacher. He was stating in the context of this that he also was the one that killed Christians and persecuted Christians, and he lived a horrible life as a Pharisee. But when he got changed, he got changed. On the road to Damascus, God even changed his name, showing him that you're no longer Saul. Now I'm going to call you Paul because I'm giving you a brand new identity. So Paul was never ashamed to be the apostle or the servant of God that he called him to be. Someone told me the other day, they said, well, Brother Bill, it seems very arrogant, very prideful for me to tell people that I'm holy or I'm sanctified or I'm a saint. Let me tell you something. It's not arrogant. It's not prideful to believe what God says about you is true. You're simply repeating the truth. You're not bragging on yourself. You're bragging on God. What a way to brag on God. What a way to bless his beautiful name, to sanctify his name in the eyes of the people, to say, you know, Jesus died to make me a saint, so I'm a saint. You may not think I'm a saint. Your interpretation of a saint may be different, but I'm telling you right now, I'm a saint. Jesus died to make me a saint. I am what I am. Y'all understand that? So here's 10 statements. I got these on your notes I handed out. 10 statements. We could have written 100, but 10 that I like the best on who God says that I am. He says I'm a child of God. He says I'm a new creature, born again, new man, brand new. I am a saint, a holy one. I am in Christ. I am forgiven. I am righteous. I am an heir of God. I am a citizen of heaven. I am God's workmanship. I'm connected to the source of life. 10 I ams. 10 of what God says about me. Now let me put a period there and draft a little inserted paragraph. If you're not a Christian, if you've never been saved, if you've been running from Jesus your whole life, you know, these things don't apply to you. But if you will give him your heart, if you will ask him into your life and repent of your sins and call upon the name of the Lord, he'll give you a born-again experience. He will come inside your heart, he'll wash all your sins away, and he'll place you in Christ. And then everything I'm about to say for the next few minutes will be true of you the very second after you give your heart to Jesus. The greatest day of a person's life is when they get saved, when they get born again. It shouldn't take us so many years to figure out what really happened to us. But in my case, it has. It's been a constant unfolding of greater revelation of what God has did for me on the day I got saved. Are y'all following me here? Okay. We'll start with some scriptures on I am a child of God. Romans 8, 14 through 16. This is a different kind of sermon. I'm just going to speak these truths into your heart. And I'm going to pray the Holy Spirit will light on it and quicken it to you and burn it in your heart to where you get a revelation to say, wow, I'm really a child of God. Look at the verse. For all who are led by the Spirit of God are sons of God. For you did not receive the spirit of slavery to fall back into fear, but you've received the spirit of adoption as sons, by whom we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself bears witness with our spirit that we are the children of God. One of the main ministries of the Holy Spirit in your life is to give you the revelation that you're actually a child of God. If the Holy Spirit can do that for you, I just think that's one of the key ministries of the Holy Spirit. You'll never know it any other way. Look at Ephesians 1:5. In love, he predestinated us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. Galatians 3:26, for you're all children of God through faith in Christ Jesus. How did you become a child of God? Through faith, by believing. When you got saved, you became a child of God. We were actually homeless orphans. Think of that analogy. Homeless orphans. And Jesus comes to the orphanage house and purchases us. He buys us with his own blood. And God handpicked you out of that crowd. He says, you're mine. I'm going to adopt you. I'm going to bring you from this orphanage and I'm going to give you a seat at the family table. Now you're going to be seated at the table with God your Father, who owns the whole universe, with Jesus Christ, His only begotten Son. You're going to become an heir of God and a joint heir of Jesus Christ. Now you don't need to live like a homeless orphan anymore. You're a child of the King. You're a child of the owner of the universe. You're a child of God Himself. You say, well, I know that, Brother Bill. Well, quit living like a homeless orphan and start living like a child of the King. Galatians 4:7, you're no longer a slave, but God's own child. And since you're His child, God made you His heir. I love those verses. I'm a part of the family of God. Romans 8:29, for God knew His people in advance. This is NLT. And He chose them to become like His Son, so that His Son would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. You're part of a family now. The family of God. What a promise. You can go from being a homeless orphan to be the richest kid in all the universe. You're now part of a family. God has a family where He makes us all heirs and joint heirs with Jesus Christ. You belong to Jesus, Ephesians 1:6. He gave you the right to choose, John 1:12. That one's worth looking at. But to all who did receive Him, who believed in His name, He gave the right to become children of God. Now your King James Bible is going to say He gave you power to become a child of God or a son of God. I always thought I couldn't understand that. Because if I already was a son of God, what do I need power to become a son of God? Well, look it up in your Strong's Concordance. Not a good translation at all. It actually means He gave you the right to choose to become a child of God. He gave you the right to choose. See, the Holy Spirit's going to draw you to Jesus, but you've got to make that choice. God won't violate your will. You have to choose Him. Every time you choose Him, it brings Him pleasure. Every time you choose Him, it makes His heart skip and sing. Every time one of us says yes to the Lord, I'll choose You. I've got the right to choose. I can choose whether I want to be His son or not. I can choose whether I want to be a part of the family table. I can choose whether or not I want to be His from now on. And my choice is yes. Amen. I vote yes. I'm with You, Jesus. You've got the right to choose. I'm a child of God. He loves me unconditionally. 1 John 3:1. See what kind of love the Father has given to us, that we should be called children of God, and so we are. Why did He do this? Because He loves you. Not because you deserved it. I didn't deserve it. None of us deserve this kind of blessing. He just loves us that much, that He would send His Son to die for our sins, to reconcile us back to Him. He would send Jesus to the cross because He loved me and you so much, He wanted to make us His children. Look at Ephesians 2:4. But God, being rich in mercy because of the great love with which He loved us, even when we were dead in our trespasses, made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved. And in 2 Timothy 1:7, God hath not given us a spirit of fear, but of power and of love and a sound mind. Why? Because we're His child. I'm a child. I'm a child of the King. I'm a child of God the Father Himself. I'm not bragging on me. I'm bragging on Him. He made me this way. He adopted me. He did this for me. Nothing good I have done to deserve this. He did this just because He loved me. 1 John 4, such love has no fear because perfect love expels all fear. If we're afraid, it's for fear of punishment. And this shows we've not yet fully experienced perfect love. Are you still afraid God's going to punish you? This is part of the problem why we can't see that we're part of the family of God. If you were raised in a dysfunctional home, if you had a drunk for a dad that beat your mama up or beat you up, it's real hard for you to get an image of what a perfect father is all about. I was raised in a good home. They took me to church every week. It was a good God-fearing Baptist home. But still, it wasn't a perfect home. And it's hard for me to understand what a perfect father is like. But I'm telling you right now, He does not get drunk and throw you up against the wall. In fact, He won't punish you unless it's the last resort. If He sees you hell-bent on going your own way where you're about to destroy your life, yeah, He'll bring chastening and punishment into your life to get you back. But that's a last resort. He doesn't take pleasure in punishing you. Some people don't want to let anybody know they're sick because they think if they get sick, God's punishing them. That's not true. Beloved, we get sick because we're human beings. We're living in a body of sin and death that's on its way to the grave. Our body is getting older, and age and decay and death is part of the curse. One day it's going to give us a glorified body. One day we'll have a resurrected body. One day this will all be behind us. But you're not being punished by God just because you get sick. Are y'all following that? I can approach God with boldness and confidence. I have boldness instead of fear at the judgment seat. Look at that verse. By this love is perfected, 1 John 4:17. By this love is perfected with us so that we may have confidence in the day of judgment. Because as He is, so also are we in this world. As He is, so also are we. Can you believe that, or does that sound too far-fetched for you to grab? As He is, so also. What do you mean? Because you're in Christ now. You're in Christ. You're supernaturally been baptized into Christ. So as He is, so also are you. You say, well, Brother Hudson, you don't know me, man. I've got a lot of things that aren't Christ-like. I'm not talking about that part of you. I'm talking about this part of you who's a child of God. Look at this verse, Jeremiah 29:11. For I know the plans that I have for you, declares the Lord, plans for welfare and not calamity, to give you a future and a hope. That doesn't sound like a God trying to punish you or trying to make your life miserable. No, God's a good God who intentionally loves you. Now look, here's my recap on these verses in white. I'm a child of God. God's my loving Father, and He owns everything in the universe. My heavenly dad is all-powerful, omnipresent, all-knowing. His heart is full of unconditional love and perfect justice. In fact, He will never stop loving me. He adopted me. He chose me to be His son. I was a homeless orphan, and He picked me. He picked me. He loves me on my worst day or my best day. He is intentional about helping me and blessing me. I am His child, and we are His family. I am His heir, and no man can take me out of His hand. I am secure in His love. Man, when you really believe that, if you really will believe that, no longer will walk in fear, no longer will we walk in poverty or not thinking that. Don't you understand? He'll supply every need that we have. We just need to put our trust in Him. If you had a child living with you and that child was hungry and naked, you would clothe them, you would feed them, you'd make sure they're taken care of. He's a greater father than you are, a greater mother than you are, and He's going to take care of His children. We don't need to live in fear or anxiety. We don't need to be concerned about where our next meal's coming from. I've never seen the righteous forsaken or his seed begging bread. God will meet all your need according to His riches in glory. I'm His child. Let's look at the second thing real quick. I'm born again. 2 Corinthians 5. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, see that key word, in Christ. In Christ is used many times through the New Testament. I think the word Christian is only 2 or 3 times in the Bible. In Christ is, I think, over 140 times you'll see this term, in Christ. Therefore, if any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. That means a brand spanking new creature. Old things are passed away. Your old identity's passed away. If you were an addict or an alcoholic before Christ, now that you're in Christ, that's not who you are anymore. You're a Christian. You're born again. You're a saint. You may need to establish the fact that you don't ever want to be an alcoholic anymore, or that's what you used to be. But beloved, if you were a womanizer, if you were a drunk, if you were a porn addict, if you were an angry person, a depressed person, all that before Christ, beloved, you were born in Adam in sin, dead in sin. Now you've been born again in Christ, alive, who Christ is your life. He's given you eternal life. So when you realize what the amazing transformation that happened on the day you got saved, of course we didn't know what all had happened to us. I was just so excited about being saved. I was excited that He had forgiven me of my sins. I was blown away by the fact that he washed all my sins away and he put them on the cross. God gave me a revelation of that the day I got born again. But here 34 years later, I'm learning more and more about what really happened to me on that glorious day. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Old things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. All things are become new. Titus 3:4. But when God our Savior revealed his kindness and love, he saved us. Not because of the righteous things we had done, but because of his mercy. He washed away our sins, giving us a new birth. King James says regeneration, a new birth, and new life through the Holy Spirit. John 3:7, Jesus' words to Nicodemus, marvel not that I say unto thee, you must be born again. There's a birth. There's a new man. This is where you get your new identity. You go from being Saul to Paul. You go from being Jacob to Israel. You go from being Abram to Abraham, Sarai to Sarah. God gives you a new name, a new identity to the day you get saved. Are y'all following this? Ephesians 1:13. And when you believed in Christ, he identified you as his own. The day you believed in Jesus, the day you got saved, he gives you this new identity. And he gives you the Holy Spirit, whom he promised long ago. The Spirit's God's guarantee that he will give us the inheritance he promised and that he has purchased us to be his own people. So the day you got saved, you also received the Holy Spirit, God's Spirit, fused with your spirit, where you, in your spirit, in your inner man, you had this new birth, this new identity. Now God's Spirit's fused with your spirit, and this is the part of you that's in right relationship with God. It will never get more or less right relationship. It's as he is, so are we. This is the part of you that's holy and righteous, your spirit man. Now you do have a soul. Next week we're going to talk about our carnal souls that need fixing, that needs transforming. It won't nearly be as encouraging as this lesson but it's what you got to have. You got to get some stuff out of you to be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might become Christ-like. His ultimate intention for your life is that you become sons and daughters that act like Jesus act, that behave the way Jesus behaved, that have the mind of Christ and the will of God in their heart, and they live in the footsteps of Jesus. That's God's ultimate intention, is to make you conformed into the image and likeness of his Son. Are you following that? But the day you get born again, don't minimize what happened, or don't take away what happened. The devil wants to minimize your born again experience to try to say, oh, look at you. You're still a failure. You're still worthless. You're still no good. You're never going to amount to anything. You come to church, you study, you still got these wrong habits. See, that devil's a liar. You got to tell him he's a liar. And you got to say, no, all things have become new. My old has passed away. All things have become new. I'm a new creature. I've been born again. I've been regenerated. I have a relationship with God. I've been picked by God. I was an orphan. Now part of his family. I'm a child of the living God. Christ lives in me. Colossians 1:27. Christ in you, the hope of glory. He lives inside of me. Jesus lives inside of me. My body's the temple of the Holy Spirit. And then my new man doesn't sin. John 5:18. We know that whosoever is born of God sinneth not. You see? You can't say, well, you've been born again, but you still sin. Some people get trapped here and they spend their whole Christian life and say, oh, I don't sin anymore. I haven't sinned since the day I got saved. One, you're lying. Two, you're just ignorant or stupid. I mean, just pay attention. We all sin. The Bible says if you say you hadn't sinned, you're lying. And the truth's not in you. No, we're all going to sin. But what he's saying is, whosoever's born of God, that part of me that was born of God, that part of me that was born again, that part of me that was regenerated in my spirit, he don't sin anymore. That's why your spirit can't ever be possessed by a devil. God lives there. If you're a Christian, you might be oppressed like we talked about last week, but not possessed. If you're a lost person and your spirit is dead, then it's an open dwelling place for spirits to come and live, if they choose to possess you. Are you following that? I don't mean to revert back to last week. I hope you guys are getting this. I have a new identity. 1 Peter 2:10. Once you had no identity as a people, now you are God's people. I have an identity now. Look at my words here. This is my recap on this. I am a new creation. My spirit has been regenerated. I have been born again. I was born on this earth, dead in Adam, dead in sin. But now I've been born again in Christ, made alive. I have His eternal life. I'm a new man with a new identity in Christ, who is my life. My relationship with Christ defines who I am. This is my deepest, truest identity. In Christ, I'm not who I used to be before Christ. Instead, I'm everything God's Word says that I am. I am that I am. I am that I am. I'm born again. I've got a new man, a new identity. I am now a child of God. The king's kid, son of a king, son of the owner of the universe, son of the creator of all things. I'm a child. He's going to love me. He's going to protect me. He's going to grow me up. He's going to bless me and care for me. I'm His child. I'm not going to live like a homeless orphan anymore. I'm not going to live in fear anymore. I'm going to live in love. I'm going to live from the context that He loves me, and my relationship with Him is secure in that love. There was a man one time, heard a story that he got mugged behind a McDonald's in Georgia, and he injured his head real bad. And when they were healing him up in the hospital, they realized he had forgot everything about his life. He had total amnesia. And they got his wallet and his driver's license, so he didn't know who he was. He had lost his identity. So people found out about this, and the FBI came and did prints and DNA testing trying to find it. Dr. Phil heard about it and put him on TV and see if anybody knew him at all would come forward. No one did. Dr. Phil hired a investigator and investigated, could not make any connections with any other person. And 8 years later, this man still did not know who he was. Can you imagine? Well, that's what the devil wants to do to us. He wants to steal your identity. When you got saved, God gave you this new identity. And the devil's been working ever since that day trying to get you to steal that truest identity. See, who I am is who I am in Christ. And because I am in Christ, I'm righteous. I'm holy. I'm sanctified. I'm justified. I'm redeemed. I'm a citizen of heaven. You know, who I am in Christ changes everything for me. And I'm not bragging on myself. I'm bragging on what Jesus did 2,000 years ago on a cross. And because of that, I can receive this new born again, new identity. Like Jacob's name was changed to Israel, so does God want to change your name, your nature. He wants to change everything about you. And you've got to live through this identity, though, to see it work. Remember, your behavior doesn't determine your identity. Your identity determines your behavior. So if I think I'm holy and Christ-like and a saint, then I'm going to live like a saint. It changes everything. All right, I'm not going to take much more of your time. I'm going to let you take this home and read it. But give me a few more verses here. I am a saint, a holy one. When Paul wrote his letters to the church at Ephesus, to the church at Philippi, and the church at Colossae, all three letters he started out to the saints, to the saints. Everybody he wrote to the saints. He was talking about everyone. Some of these people have just been saved a short period of time. But when you get saved, he calls you a saint. 1 Peter 2:9, you're a chosen people. You're a royal priest, a holy nation, God's very own possession. That's who God says you are. 1 Corinthians 1:2. To the church of God that is in Corinth. This is Paul's letter to the Corinthians. To those sanctified in Christ Jesus, called to be saints together with all those who in every place call upon the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. So who's called to be a saint? Everybody that will call upon the name of the Lord Jesus Christ. That's how you become a saint. If you've been saved 1 minute, God calls you a saint. I'm telling you, I worked my whole life trying to be a good enough person where I might be considered a saint by someone, maybe my pastor, I don't know. If you're in a Roman Catholic church, if you really do great in life, they'll make a saint out of you. And that's a big honor there. But beloved, we're saints now. I'm not a sinner trying hard to become a saint anymore. I'm a saint who's working on becoming like Christ. That might be the most powerful thing I'll say to you today. I am not a sinner trying to become a saint anymore. I'm giving up on that. I'm going to acknowledge who I am in Christ. I'm a saint working on becoming more Christ-like. God's Word says that I'm a holy one. I realize that apart from Christ, I would still be a sinner. But because of Christ and what He's done for me, I'm now a saint, a holy one. I say that I'm a saint with the deepest humility. I am not proud or arrogant stating I'm a saint because I boast in God and not myself. He did it. God made me that. Jesus died that I might be that. I'm not trying to tell you I'm live holier life than Brother David or Sister Grace Jean. We're not measuring ourselves who's the holiest one. I mean, how holy, what could you do to possibly make yourself more holy than what Jesus did at the cross? It's not in how much effort I put into being a holy person. It's believing that I am a saint. And because I believe that, guess what kind of life I'm going to live? I'm going to live a holy life. Are y'all following that? I am a saint because I boast in God, not myself. God made me a saint the day He put me in Christ. I don't become a saint by trying harder than others to be a holy man. I am holy. All glory goes to God. I want y'all to start believing that about yourself. You might not want to go tell everyone at work, walk in there and tell them you're a saint, got this great revelation, but maybe it'd be a good thing to call your wife a saint. Let her call you a saint. That's better than some of those other things they call you, right? Hey, saint. I like that. Saint David, huh? That's good. It's got a ring to it. Saint Grace Jean. How's that? I like that. The other thing that the Bible, if you could do a study on this, it absolutely changed your life, because the moment you got saved, He put you in Christ. So one of our I am's, 10 I am's, is I am in Christ. And in 1 Corinthians 12:13, you'll see that when you got saved, you were baptized by the Holy Spirit into the body of Christ, into Christ, baptized into Christ the moment you got saved. 1 Corinthians 1:30, this is one of the most wonderful verses in the Bible. Because of Him, God, because of Him, you are in Christ Jesus. Because of God the Father, you're in Christ Jesus, who became to us wisdom from God, righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. Righteousness, sanctification, and redemption. You don't earn those three things. You got them the moment He put you in Christ. He made you righteous. He sanctified you. He redeemed you. Whoa, I love that verse. And then Romans 8:1, there's no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus. Are you condemned today? It's because you don't know that you're in Christ. Get inside of Christ. Live through that identity. You won't feel the condemnation, the guilt, or the shame that comes from being a human being. It is powerful. Thank you. I love that. And then Colossians 2:9, I'm complete in Christ. For in Him dwelleth all the fullness of the Godhead bodily, and ye are complete, how? In Him. Which is the head of all principality and power. Powerful. In Christ. I'm dead. Colossians 3:3. For ye are dead and your life is hid with Christ in God. I love that. I'm dead, man. I am so dead. My old nature, my old sinful Adamic nature is dead. It died with Him at the cross. And now my life is hid with Christ in God. My old man's crucified with Christ. Galatians 2:20. I'm crucified with Christ. Nevertheless, I live, yet not I, but Christ liveth in me. So my old nature was crucified with Him. And then Romans 6:6-8 in ESV, I love this. We know that our old self was crucified with Him in order that the body of sin might be brought to nothing. Nothing. You're crucified. And that means your old man was eradicated. Your old man was destroyed at the cross. Your old man was brought to nothing. Doesn't sound like you'd be wrestling all your life with nothing, does it? No, if it's nothing, there's nothing to wrestle with. Again, it's like the third shoe analogy. You don't need a third shoe, right? I don't need the old man anymore. He's brought to nothing. He's not an issue in my life anymore. Wow. So that we would no longer be enslaved to sin. I'm not enslaved to a nothing. He's been brought to nothing. He's not my master anymore. For one who has died has been set free from sin. Now, if we've died with Christ, we believe that we'll also live with Him. Did you die with Him or not? Live with Him now. Live with Him through your new identity, through your new man. You've been born again. Live with Him. Christ, who is our life. I love this kind of stuff. It's just good stuff, man. And I'm telling you right now, I don't know which verse it'll be, but if you'll take that handout home, and if you won't, don't read them fast, go slow. Just go slow and meditate on one verse at a time. I'm believing you're going to have these moments like I've had in the last 3 weeks where I just start weeping. It just overwhelms me. You know, just the Romans 8 scripture just overwhelmed me. I'm not a homeless orphan anymore. I've been adopted. I got a seat at the family dinner table. So do that. I promise this will change you. This will transform you, believing who you are, who God says you are. I'll skip some. I guess I need to start shutting this down. I'll read my little recap. I've been a born-again Christian for over 34 years, and I knew that Christ lived in my heart. But only in the past 3 or 4 years did I learn what it means to be in Christ. Once I knew this, I believed it and received it into my life. It's totally transformed my life. Now I live in Christ, who is my life. The moment I was saved, God placed me into Christ. He made me free from sin, holy, sanctified, and put me right with God. My old man is dead, and my life is hid with Christ in God. When God looks at me, He sees His Son. In Christ, I enjoy the righteousness of God, and I do not experience condemnation anymore. Powerful, what it means to be in Christ. I'm forgiven. Powerful verses there. Go home, read them. I'm righteous. This I do want to read to you. And I'm going to shut her down. We're not going to finish it. I promise. I give you my word. 2-minute warning, man. We're at the end of this thing right now. In Him. It's my favorite verse in the Bible. 2 Corinthians 5:21. God made Him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in Him we might become the righteousness of God. Romans 4:22, and because of Abraham's faith, God counted him as righteous. And when God counted him as righteous, it wasn't just for Abraham's benefit. It was recorded for our benefit too, assuring us that God will also count as righteous if we believe in Him. How do we get righteous? Believing in Him. Faith. If you'll believe that God put you in Christ and start living out of that, just start believing that, beloved, you're going to start living like you're in Christ. You're going to start living a holy life, a pure life, a clean life. Things that you've been struggling with all your life, you won't struggle with them anymore. You'll realize the old man is brought to nothing. He has no more power. You're not under his rulership anymore. You're not a slave of the flesh anymore. Now you're a love slave to Jesus Christ because He put you in Christ. Amen. All right. I'm not going to do it. We're just going to. Y'all stand up and we'll be dismissed. Amen. Amen. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. Let's just take a moment and pray. Dear Lord Jesus, I thank You for Your word. Lord, this really wasn't a sermon today. I just knew I was supposed to read those scriptures. And Lord, we love Your word. This church loves Your word. And Lord, I just pray that the Holy Spirit would join together with Your living word and that it would quicken these great truths to the people of return. If this entire congregation could understand who we are in Christ and start living that way, I know then that this could be a congregation that can change our entire community. I'll know then that revival can come. You can trust us with revival as we know who our truest identity is in You. And Lord, Satan wants to rob us of that identity. He's been trying to steal that from us ever since we became Christians. And Lord, like the man with no identity, you know, we're not living that way. We are who you say we are. I am that I am. I am who you say I am in Christ. I am a son of God. I am a citizen of heaven. I am righteous. I am sanctified. I am made holy. I am a saint, Lord God. And I don't boast on my ability to behave a certain way. All my boast is in you, Jesus, and what you did for me 2,000 years ago on a tree. So, Lord, I just pray that these truths be quickened to our hearts. And, Lord, if there's anyone here today that doesn't know you, Jesus, I pray that they could make a choice for you right now, that they would choose. They would choose, that they understand they have the right to choose you. And you don't violate our will. You don't make us do anything. You just draw us and lead us, and then we choose you.